Asking questions, interviews, it should be fun. Can we do that again? Hi, my name's Frank Sanchez, and we're here doing interviews in the Waikiki, Oahu, meeting, it should be fun. Excuse me, sir, can I, some questions, please? Okay, can I interview some questions, please? For school? Oh, okay.
No, I definitely don't.
What do you think, presidents?
The president?
Yeah, the campaign.
I hope Trump wins. But I'm not from America.
So okay, okay. Do you follow American politics?
A little bit.
Okay, okay. Well, there's no President's Day at school for PacRim.
Sorry?
No President's Day for school at PacRim.
Oh, I don't know.
Oh, okay. Okay, what do you think about the current debate presidential?
I don't know. I haven't really been following it.
Okay. Donald Trump?
Not sure.
What do you, teamwork?
What do I what?
Think about teamwork.
Teamwork? I think it's important.
Why?
Because you can't function as a team without it. Like, there's not unity. Everyone plays a certain part and they have to work together.
No, me and team, huh?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, have you, been, are you... Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Do you, elliptical?
Nope.
You work out?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Oh,
a little bit.
Yeah. School, no. I'm sorry. I'm a little nervous. School, no DCAT. No school on DCAT. What do you think about Waikiki?
Well, it's my first few hours here.
Oh, okay.
So far, pretty good.
Okay.
I thought so.
Sandy ankles.
I don't know what you're specifically pertaining to goal setting for my life.
Like soccer goals.
Oh, right on.
Yeah.
What about soccer goals? My kids play soccer.
Oh. Oh,
okay. Yeah.
What are your thoughts?
I think that it takes a team to...
You must work as a team.
Yes.
If not, it doesn't. Not good.
Yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
What about goal for life?
Same thing. It takes a team to make it through your life. Yeah. If you don't have your team around you, it's kind of hard.
Merenam Josiah, hey?
Oh, merenam Vijay.
Acha, ab kahan se aa rahe
hain? Ab Vishakhapatnam se aa rahe hain.
Main ek baar gaya wahan.
विशाखापट्टनम
हां मैं मसूरी से आ रहा हूं
मसूरी से
हां आप कभी गए
नहीं मसूरी कभी
अच्छा थोड़े दूर है ना
हां
वहां से
हमसे दूर है
अच्छा आप कितने देर तक रहेंगे
5 दिन
5 दिन बस उसके बाद कहां जा रहे हैं
सैन फ्रांसिस्को
बहुत अच्छा जगह मैं कभी नहीं गया
सैन फ्रांसिस्को
लेकिन आप लोग वहां कितने देर लगे
उधर ही रह रहे हैं अभी
अच्छा आपका परिवार वहां है
हां
अच्छा Okay.
Get in the Word, and the Word is going to prepare us for worship. It's going to be a beautiful thing. We're going to have worship at the end. But so right now, we have from Chapel Team Trace, Al. Al is going to be bringing the worship, the Word for us. So we have to give you a round of applause.
like that? First thing I want to say is, after watching the video first, I wish I got to do a video and get a couple of retakes instead of just doing a cold right now. Okay. Good morning, everybody.
Morning.
Today's message, our group decided that we would do it on spiritual discipline. I'm going to be reading from John 15, verses 9 through 10. It's in the New King James Version. The title is Love and Joy Perfect. We're trying to tie everything together along with Valentine's Day, too. A little love in there. As the Father loved me, I have also loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. Those two verses, they're short, they're very poignant, and they speak right to what it takes to get to that level. And spiritual discipline is the way you got to get to it. And in researching this, I didn't know that as I was doing things along the line, you know, prayer and understanding what God was saying, that there was actually points that you would connect together to get from one point to the other. And the best one I came up with for spiritual discipline was, it's a habit or a regular pattern in your life that repeatedly brings you closer to God. So in other words, everything you're trying to do, you're trying to get, you know, to some message or some point from God, it repeatedly ends right back up with God. So it starts with Him, ends with Him. The reason we need spiritual discipline is to understand God's love for us, especially as Christians. And one of the key points for that is endurance. I'll give you two examples. One, endurance is going to be from an athletic standpoint. Most of us play high school sports. Some of us were really good at playing college sports. To get to the level that we needed to play the game, we had to set aside time each and every day to work out, to run, to whatever it is you were trying to attain, so you'd be okay once you got out there on the ball field, basketball court, etc. In an academic sense, you need endurance, because whether you're trying to get an A, getting a B, getting your associate degree, getting your bachelor's degree, even some here getting their master's degrees, it takes endurance, okay? So that same endurance that we apply to athletics and academics also transpires to the endurance we need to feel what God is trying to do in our lives and the steps we need to get there. So what I want to tell you about is, we have some spiritual disciplines, and I made a list of seven. After endurance, get the next slide. There we go. Knowing the Word of God, studying the Bible, memorizing Scripture, meditating on Scripture, and prayer. Those are five ways, as I was researching all this, that pretty much everyone that was writing on it, these were the keys that they put into it. And I'll just give you a couple examples. When I think of memorizing Scripture, I think of Proverbs, okay? You memorize a proverb, you get it down, and you relate it to something you're dealing with. When I think of meditating on Scripture, I think of Psalms. I think of David. I think when David was writing the majority of Psalms, I think he really sat and he meditated on what he was feeling at that time, and then wrote it down, and then we use it, you know, in our Bible today. Those are five. The last one I want to talk to you about on that one is prayer. Prayer is going to tie into it at the end. I'll give you two personal examples. It'll go back to endurance through prayer to get an answer. In 1999, I was doing fine, and all of a sudden, over a period of a couple weeks, I came down with this really bad illness. And my wife and I couldn't figure out what the heck it was, but it was internal, and it was ripping me up. And I started praying to God. This is the endurance part. I was like, God, can you tell me what's going on right now? I cannot figure it out for the life of me. Long story short, a year and a half goes by. I'm still praying. I'm still dealing with it, and I don't know what I have. My wife comes home. She worked in the medical library at the base, and she put down this thing on the table, and she said, this is what you have. Go to the doctor and tell him this is what you've got. and then let's start dealing with it. I go to the doctor, he concurs. A year and a half to 2 years, God answers that prayer. I finally figured out what I had. Over the next 4 or 5 years, they came up with these injections I had to take. Really, they were painful. It was really a heck of a way to go through what I was dealing with. And I'm still praying. I'm asking God, please take this away from me. You know, it's too much. I can't handle it. 5 or 6 years in, the doctor says, hey, there's this medicine. It might work and stop your injections. But it's going to take 9 months to work to see if it, you know, it'll work for you. And also, it only works in 40% of the people. I didn't care at that time. I said, I'll take it. I just prayed. I kept praying. We were both doing it. Excuse me. God, finally, at the end of that 9 months, it works. So I get on to that part. Now I'm about 10 years into this illness. There's no cure. There's nothing they can do for me. So I accepted that part. But I still kept praying. I said, God, if there's ever a cure, if there's just some way I can get some relief, you know, I'll be forever grateful. In 2014, my wife and I went to Israel for our 20th anniversary. And if any of you have been to Israel, you know it's a pilgrimage and it's a life-changing event. And we were there for 10 days. And the Bible actually, it came alive. I was really praying deep into what I, you know, was going on physically. And about 2 or 3 months after, I can't remember the exact month, week, but 2 or 3 months later, my symptoms started to go away. And within 6 months, I was in total remission. Fifteen years from the start to the end. Now it's in remission, and I'm just saying, God, I'll take it as long as you'll give it to me. The second one I want to tell you about is more of a personal level. This is endurance through prayer. We left here in 95. I was still in the Air Force. I still had another 5 or 6 years ago. And I knew we couldn't come back to Hawaii in that time. I was here for 5 years. I was from here. And I was really sad. I did not want to leave, ever. I was like, I found the place I wanted to live. Gotta go. 7 years, I know there's nothing I can do about it. Then I retire, and I'm asking God, God, send us back to Hawaii. We even bought a house over here because it's like we knew we were coming back. Long story short, year after year goes on. Every January, I would psych myself up and say, I know we're going to move this summer. It's the school break. Our son's out of school. But now he had to get a job. She had too much time with what she was doing that she had to get a transfer back here. So that was contingent on that. And every year, the summer would come, and the transfer wouldn't happen. And then we were stuck for another year. And she kept telling me, God's time, not yours. When are you going to listen? The next year, I go through the same thing. Came all the way out till last year, 20 years from the time we left. God opened the door. She got a transfer back here, and we moved back in May. The point of that story is it was prayer and endurance the whole way. And it was using spiritual disciplines that I didn't even know. I didn't know about this portion of it. I just knew about prayer and my own little piece of it. And in my own mind, trying to make it work. And then, of course, you know, your spouse, she's seeing you who you are, and she's calling you and saying, no, this is the deal. You got to wait. And if he says no, it's no until he says yes, right? It's tough to take though, right? It's just the flesh that we are. So those are ways to spiritual discipline. Discipline works by indirection. We can't do it on our own. Trying's not enough. It has to be a dedicated effort using some of the following ways. And I listed 9 of them. There's 4 right there. First one is solitude. Silence, fasting, keeping the Sabbath, secrecy, submission, worship, personal sacrifice, personal reflection, and service. And I'll just touch on a couple of them. The one that comes to mind for me first is solitude. If I'm reading the Bible and I'm trying to make this work in my mind, whatever it is I'm dealing with at that time, I need total silence. I can't have TV on in the other room. Somebody's listening to the radio. I can't have my neighbor cutting the grass. I have to have silence and listen to God and to what he's telling me, or sometimes if he's not telling me. Fasting. I started fasting maybe 10 years ago. Very difficult at first. Some people can fast for a couple days on end. Some people fast from morning till night. Some people fast from morning to the next morning. For me, what worked was I would fast after dinner to the next night at dinner. And then that way, during the day, I was able to listen to the Christian radio shows, to read the Bible, or do whatever I was trying to do. And I didn't yearn for that hunger so bad because of the way I was dealing with it. So fasting for all of us works in different ways. But it does work. It does work. You know, I didn't understand it until I did it. I want to touch on personal reflection. When you put all those 9 things that we had up there and then the other 5 I talked about initially, when you group all of them together and what you were seeking from God and how you were trying to understand God, you would sit back and I would personally reflect on exactly what I dealt with, whether what I wanted came true, whether it didn't. And let's face it, in life, the majority of the time, we don't get what we want. That's what makes when we get what we want so much greater. And we thank God, because when we don't get what we want, usually a few days, a few years, a few months later, you understand why that didn't happen that way, and that's God. God saying, I'm in control, I'm telling you how it's gonna work out. You gotta wait on me though. You have to wait on me. And that's the silence part of this. I think once you read the scripture, you pray, you figure out what it is you're trying to see, and then you just go silent on it for a little while until it all comes back to you. I think as Christians, God answers this no matter what it is, whether it's what we want to hear or what we don't want to hear. I think through these disciplines, we can all work out our own salvation. Paul said, remember, we all have to work out our own salvation in our own way. So whether you use these disciplines in the order that they're in, or you use them in this portion of your life, or this point of your life, I don't think it's to take all 9 or all the first 5 and just do them in order. You gotta do it to what is best for you, to how God's speaking to you. That's just what I believe. The last thing I wanna say on this is that I started off with spiritual discipline is a habit. It's a regular pattern. It's something that we do every day and we do repeatedly. And it starts with God, and it does a 360 and comes back to God. If we look at spiritual discipline in that way, I think it'll help us gain a greater understanding of the love and joy that God talks about in John. Thank you very much.
You guys doing good this morning? Yeah. Well, we're about to start our worship set. Let's just pray. God, we love you. We thank you so much, God. We praise you for everything you're doing in this place, God, and we give you all the glory and all the honor. And God, we just come out with a bang today, and we just say, God, you are good, and you love us.
Amen.
We praise you. In your name we pray. Amen. Cause our God is great, greatly to be praised.
Let go and don't We are not identified by what we do, or the grades we get, or what we accomplish, but we are identified because of the blood of Jesus Christ who died for us. And His Spirit says, you are sons, you are daughters, you are forgiven. We can actually yell out His name with praise and victory because of what you've done 2,000 years ago, Lord Jesus. You walk in confidence today. So, Lord Jesus, would you refresh our souls, reaffirming again who we are in you, reaffirming that we are your people, reaffirming that we are valuable to you, Lord Jesus, that you want us, Jesus, that you pursued us, Jesus, even when we were dead in our transgressions, but you pursued us, Jesus. The Savior said, the life change in me is gone. The shadow of me is lost. Find in me, thine home is gone. Jesus paid it all to me, shall.
if, Lord God, you paid it all, we can walk out this place in security and in boldness, knowing that we are covered under the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and that nothing else can ever separate us ever again. We are free. You have won. You have inside us. And we will forever declare your name. God, you start a fire in this place. In each one of our hearts, God, you start a fire. We just thank you, God. We just thank you. We need to take a moment. We just start to lift our voice up and just praise you. Thank you, God. We praise you. God, we love you. Come on, God. Let's lift you up. God, as he says, we go on today. We'll be different. And we ask you to just bless the food, bless our fellowship. God, let's love one another here. We praise your name. We give you all the glory. Come on. Know what we say. Amen. Hey guys, sorry, I know we're hungry, we're going to get through this quick. First one is actually really important. Understand our hearts are coming from this from a student life perspective. But similar to mentioned, there's a good portion of students who are finding falling behind in their payments. So what we want to do is offer you the, just to extend the opportunity to come and talk to us about it. Because a lot of times it's hard, we don't have to hear for different reasons, and God provides different seasons. So we want to work with you individually with those matters. At the same time, we know that there's policy, and just to remember that we have an enrollment contract. An enrollment contract states that, if you have an outstanding balance by the end of the semester, if you have an outstanding balance before semester begins, they won't let you register. Or if you're one of those who are looking forward to graduating soon, you can't graduate with an outstanding balance at the same time. So we want to work these things with you and see how we can creatively come to solutions.
If you're struggling making payments and that kind of stuff.
But it comes with us to address those things, just come in and talk about them. Don't keep continuing school and not just kind of avoiding those, that issue. Come talk to us. Katrina's more than willing to help. The Student Life is here to help you find solutions. Can we do that?
Yeah.
Awesome. Thank you so much. On the letter, no. How many of you guys like conferences? So, as you know, Jehovah's having their premier DCAP conference for churches and teams. We have no school, but we are looking forward to inviting us as the PacRim family to their OG conference on Tuesday night from 7 until about 8:30. It's going to be completely free for PacRim students. So, if you're interested and you want to sign up for it, Will Goodman is in the back for you. There'll be a list and sign up sheets for it. So if you're looking forward to going to this conference, I know I am. See you guys there. Go see Will in the back.